Good evening. We welcome you on this Maundy, Thursday. The word Maundy comes from the word mandatum, which means command. What you'll see in our scripture readings for today, Jesus gives a new command to his disciples. Jesus gives a new command to his disciples, and he's very joyful to be here tonight. So it's good. So Jesus gives the command to his disciples to love one another, and he washes their feet. And so we will see that within our scripture readings today, as well as in our liturgy. The question that we're asking today is, surely not I, Lord. That's the text for our sermon. During these Wednesdays of Lent, and especially Maundy, Thursday, and tomorrow, we're looking at the questions that surround the crucifixion and the betrayal of Jesus. And so that question is asked by the disciples, especially in regards to the betrayal. And so we ask that question of us as well, too. Surely not I, Lord, especially when he describes those that betray him. We welcome our choir today and bell choir. We also welcome those that are watching by screen as well, too. So, we begin with our opening hymn, Come to Calvary's Holy Mountain, 435. We rise to sing. Of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Jesus said, a new commandment I give you. Love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another.
By this all people will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another.
God demonstrated his own love for us. In this, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does for you. Amen. Please be seated. The Old Testament reading for today tells of the people of Israel confirming their commandment to the Lord's covenant, commitment to the Lord's covenant. As part of its confirmation, Moses and the elders were invited to eat a meal in the presence of God of Israel. Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord and all the rulers. And all the people answered with one voice and said, "All the words that the Lord has spoken, we will do." And Moses wrote down all the words of the Lord. He rose early in the morning and built an altar at the foot of the mountain. The 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel. And he sent young men of the people of Israel who offered burnt offerings and sacrificed peace offerings of oxen to the Lord. And Moses took half of the blood and put it in a basin, and the half of the blood he threw against the altar. Then he took the book of the covenant and read it in the hearing of the people. And they said, "All that the Lord has spoken, we will do, and we will be obedient." And Moses took the blood and threw it on the people and said, "Behold, the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words." Then Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and the 70 of the elders of Israel went up, and they saw the God of Israel. There was under his feet, as it were, a pavement of sapphire stone, like the very heaven of clearness. And he did not lay his hand on the chief men of the people of Israel. They beheld God and ate and drank. This ends our Old Testament lesson. Our second lesson comes from the epistle to the Corinthians. Paul teaches us in tonight's epistle that we enjoy a true oneness with our Lord, Jesus Christ, and with each other as Christians as we partake together of the Holy Supper of his body and blood. The cup of blessing we bless, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? And the bread that we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, and for we all partake of the one bread. We rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. In many and various ways God spoke to his people of old by the prophets. Maundy, Thursday, comes from the Old English word, maunda, which means command. In this gospel, Holy Gospel, Jesus gives us his manda, or to love one another, both by his example and by direct command. It was just before the Passover the Passover feast, Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. The evening meal was being served, and the devil had already prompted Judas Iscariot, son of Simon, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." Then the Lord, Simon Peter replied, "Not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Jesus answered, "A person who has both had a bath needs only to wash his feet. His whole body is clean, and you are clean, though not every one of you," for he knew who was going to betray him. And that was why he said, "Not everyone was clean." When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. I tell you the truth, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. A new commandment I give you, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another." Jesus came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not come into the time of trial." Then he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done." Then an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. In his anguish, his prayer prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down on the ground. We praise you, Christ our Lord. You may be seated. Our hymn, "When You Woke That Thursday Morning."
Thank you.
Good evening. We welcome you, especially on this day, to recognize what the Lord gives us in his meal. Just recognize, please, too, that our service will end with the stripping of the altar, the reading of Psalm 22, and then we will depart in silence. Our text for our sermon today actually comes from the Gospel of St. Matthew. We read in our gospel lesson in our bulletin that Jesus took his disciples to the garden, and now we read here about how Jesus is betrayed by his disciple. And so we hear these words from Matthew 26, 21 through 28. And while they were eating, he said, "I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me." They were very sad and began to say to him, one after another, "Surely not I, Lord." Jesus replied, "The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born." Then Judas, the one who would betray him, said, "Surely not I, Rabbi." Jesus answered, "Yes, it is you." And while they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, offered it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until the day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom." When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. The question that we hear tonight is, "Surely not I, Lord." If you have been with us during these Wednesday Lenten worship, then you are aware that we are cross-examining the questions that Jesus asks around the Holy Week and the story of his crucifixion. There are a number of questions in which Jesus asks, and tonight we hear that one where Jesus describes that one of you will betray me. Any of us who have ever been in a courtroom, a live courtroom, or watched it on television recognizes that there are two sides trying to find the truth. At times we see the accused saying, "Not I, I'm not guilty." We're aware of this, aren't we? Both in public life and in television, there always seems to be a character who says, "Not I, you don't mean me, I would never do it." And of course, we know that many times a person who has done something terrible is shocked and surprised that they are seen as a phony and the accused. So it is fitting then that during the Last Supper, Jesus talks about one that will betray him. And notice what his disciples say. They say, "Surely not I, Lord." They understood the emotion of the question. Even Judas asked the question. Hypocritically, of course, he tried to hide his guilt. And we know, especially, that Judas did turn his back on the Lord. More than that, he sold him out. So the answer is given when Judas says, "Not I, Lord. Surely not I." You see, while Jesus was eating the Passover meal with his disciples, he said many things. "I tell you the truth that one of you will betray me." Early in the ministry, Jesus seemed to have conversations with his disciples about betrayal and what must take place for him as he faces himself and goes journeying toward Jerusalem. Even Peter didn't want these things to happen. And yet, Jesus was very clear that he had a purpose and that one would betray him. It must have been filled with sadness and treachery to hear that Jesus declared Judas to be the guilty one. Were the other 11 shocked that Judas had turned their back Did Judas think it was not so bad that he perpetrated this crime? I mean, knowing the background to the question and knowing that Judas himself had made plans already to betray Jesus for 30 pieces of silver must have said that answer, "Surely not I, Lord," with guilt. But it is a question, isn't it? Surely not I, Lord. I mean, Jesus announces to his disciples that one of them is guilty. But you know what's interesting? When we figure out the rest of the story, we realize that the disciples themselves will all run away. They will actually all turn their back and run away. Judas outrightly betrays Jesus by selling him for 30 pieces of silver. But what did the other disciples do as well? Did they betray their Lord? Peter, we see and know that he did that. He was told as well, too, that he would betray Jesus, and his response is, "Never, Lord, I'll die with you." It's an interesting thing, isn't it? That our Lord still, as I read, gives them communion. What does he say there when he gives them to communion? What does he say? He says those words. He says, "Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." Now we can look at Judas with contempt, and we can say, "That guy, that one betrayed Jesus." I mean, do you realize that no one has ever named a child Judas? I mean, of course, you got the band Judas Priest and all that stuff, but legally in our society, you could not give your child that name Judas because it would be rejected because of the offense that would be given to that person. And so no one is ever named Judas because of the offense that he had. He turned his back, he betrayed him. But what about if that question is asked of us? I know that we may not have sold Jesus out for 30 pieces of silver, but have we ever sold the Lord out? Have we ever closed our mouths when he calls us to speak? Has our lives reflected his love toward others all the time? I mean, think about it. All of us, at one time or another, have betrayed and are betraying Jesus. The question really comes to the heart of who we are. I mean, before each other, we look pretty good, don't we? We're not a Judas, let's get that straight. We can put on an air, a mask. We can hide ourselves with good reputation or something like that. But do we betray Jesus? I mean, on the inside, if God is looking at us, does he see that we fail? I mean, we may respond like Judas, "Surely not I, Lord," but in each of us, we have to admit deep down that we have turned our back on our Lord. Some of us may have even sold our faith for something better, whether it's a reputation, a job, maybe it's love, maybe it's a child's respect, but we turn our back on our Lord. You see, the language of betrayal is simple with Judas. You can point your finger at his sin and say, "Look what he did." But isn't there three fingers pointing back if the old adage is given? You see, what Jesus really is doing more than just revealing Judas, he's revealing all of us. And he is revealing that we are in need of a Savior. You see, in weakness and in worry, Christ came to give us his body and blood. That's why he says, "Take and eat, given for you for the forgiveness of sins." I mean, you realize that Judas is revealed publicly, that he will betray the Lord, and yet the Lord gives him communion as well. The Lord doesn't stop there in his graciousness toward us. He gives you communion as well, too, even when you fail to live up to your love of others. When you fail to be a child of God, God's forgiveness is still there for you. You see, that's what this meal is. It's where God forgives our sin. God says, "Surely you are." We would respond, "Surely not I, Lord," but the Lord would respond, "Surely you are." You see, it's not us, but it's our Lord who forgives our sins. An honest answer should be, yes, it is I, Lord. I betray you. I've done wrong. And yet, God still forgives us. See, that's what communion is. When our hearts are opened and we recognize that we have failed to live up to our calling, when we realize that, like Judas, we turn our backs, our Lord then still forgives us. He welcomes us to the communion table and to receive his body and blood, to receive his promise given for you for the forgiveness of sins. You see, that night he ended those words with the disciples. Peace I leave you. My peace I give you. I do not give you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid. Surely not I, Lord, is a good answer. But God's answer is better, given for you for the forgiveness of sins. May we find the forgiveness of Christ in this meal that we receive tonight. In his name, amen. We rise and confess our faith. Like the planting of a seed, Christ gave himself to death and burial, that he might be raised and bring new life to all mankind. Living in this trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in all things visible and invisible, in our Lord Jesus Christ,
the only begotten Son of God,
begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit
of the Virgin Mary
and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And on the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church.
I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated. Our choir will now play a piece, Gentle Songs of Grace.
Take your place at his table, the
We rise for our act of reconciliation. Oh God, when we could not come to you because we were lost in sin, you came to us in your Son, Jesus Christ. He humbled himself and became obedient even to death on the cross. His love encourages us now to approach you openly and honestly. We need to come because we know we are sinners. Your word makes us see that in thought and word and deed, we fall short of your glory. Forgive us, Father, for Jesus' sake. Lift us up to live in faith and love as your children ought to be. It is true, by ourselves we stand under God's judgment against sin. But for us, God's Son made himself nothing and took on the very nature of a servant. He who knew no sin became sin for us. He took on himself the death we deserved, atoning for our sin and redeeming us for life. In his name and then at his command, I say to you, your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We are forgiven and reconciled to God through Christ our Lord. Therefore, let us be reconciled with one another and share the peace of the Lord. The peace of the Lord be with you. Please be seated. At this time, we will receive our offering. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is our duty and our delight at all times and everywhere to give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, for you have enlightened us by the working of the Holy Spirit. Grant that the Spirit who has called and gathered us guide us in all things. Keep our witness strong so that more people may confess your power and experience your everlasting love. This we ask through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit is one God, through whom with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing.
Hosanna, Hosanna.
bold, we pray the prayer our Lord taught us in oneness. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And also after supper, he also took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them also, saying, "Take and drink. This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed also for you for the remission of sins. This do also in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, you've given us a foretaste of the feast to come and the holy supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith throughout our days of pilgrimage, that on the day of his coming, we may, together with all your saints, celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
After the Lord's Supper, less than 24 hours remained in the life of our Lord, events moved rapidly. Prayer, Gethsemane, betrayal, arrest, mock trial, painful beating, atrocious, to Golgotha, and execution. As his life was stripped from him, so we strip our altar, the signs of life, to symbolize his purposeful, redemptive suffering and death for us. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will have the light of life and will never walk in darkness. The events of Golgotha snuffed out the human light of Jesus, the light of the world. As even creation was dark when he suffered, so we extinguish our candles and remove them. Represented one way of serving God and others. They reflect God's greatest offering to the world, to us in sending his Son, Jesus in human form, as he offered the body, was removed from sight and burial. So we remove our offering. The missal stand holds our worship book, that guide our worship life together as we sing praises to God. As Jesus suffered, joyous songs are not heard. As these sounds of joy are removed from our lips, we remove the missal stand and the worship books. Jesus offered body and shed blood. Having been given to us in, with, and under the form of bread and wine in this holy mystery, as he was removed from us in the grave, so we remove the elements of the vessels of this sacrament. Our altar is in the form of a table. It is here where our Lord serves us as host and meal at his banquet feast. The paraments which adorn the altar and vestments worn by our worship leaders are made of materials appropriate for the feast of our King, as our King's body was stripped in crucifixion. So the paraments and vestments are removed. We read together Psalm 22. my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from the words of my groaning? Oh, my God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer, by night, and I am not silent. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by men and despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let the Lord rescue him. Let his delivering him, since he delights in him. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. I'm poured out like a water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart has turned to wax. It has melted away within me. My strength is dried up like the potsherd, and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay me in the dust of death. I can count all my bones. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them and cast lots for my clothing. But you, O Lord, be not far off. O my strength, come quickly to help me. Deliver my life from the sword, my previous life from the power of the dogs. Rescue me from the mouth of the lion. Save me from the horns of the wild ox. For he has not despised or disdained the suffering of the afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but has listened to his cry for help. At the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him. We leave in silence.